Hey folks, Matt Easton here, Scholar Gladiatoria. So here we are, the Battle of the Bastards, and this has been something that many of my viewers have asked me to review, and so I'm here to please the people, and so I'm going to review this battle. I have to say, first up, before I start, I really, really enjoyed it. Obviously, part of the purpose of these videos is to give constructive feedback that can sometimes sound like criticism. Sometimes it is criticism, but usually I'm quite fair with these reviews. Anyway, by and large, I thought this was a fantastic battle. I really enjoyed it. There were certain small things I rolled my eyes at, certain things I thought, yeah, that's awesome. And by and large, I thought it was really, really good, and I really, really enjoyed it. There were certain aspects of the battle, and certainly the CGI, I thought in general was really, really good. There were little bits where Jon Snow was interacting with the cavalry that it looked a bit too CGI, but I thought 1-1 the Giant was done fantastically. Particularly, I thought that just looks like a real giant. And most aspects of the way that the battle was done were passably good. They were enough for me to enjoy it. There was nothing there that ruined my enjoyment at all. The one-on-one fighting was fairly well done, and the tactics side of things was adequately done. I liked the fact that, you know, and this is something I think Game of Thrones is quite good at, they do represent the fact that in war, in battles, there are tactics. You know, people have certain ideas and there are maybe traps laid, and, you know, luring people into doing certain things so that you can exploit that. I do think by and large we didn't necessarily see that much of the scale of the battle, so most of the action was zoomed in on individuals, which is a directorial choice, I suppose. But I perhaps would have liked to have seen a little bit more panned out tactics, but you know, I'm someone who spends all my time reading about military history and warfare and tactics and things like that, so I'm not a typical viewer. So I accept that for a normal viewer, this gave us both a bit of the one-on-one action, in fact a lot of it, and it gave us a bit of the sort of bigger scale battlefield tactics. So, moving on to some specific things that I'm going to review and talk about in this, I must say it is a long battle scene in terms of the length within the episode. So, I'm not going to show the whole thing, and I'm not going to talk about every single thing in it, because that would make a ridiculously long video that unfortunately I don't have the time to shoot, and probably none of you would watch the whole length of. So I'm just going to pick out some specific bits. So first up, the arrangement of the Bolton army. What did I think about it? It was okay. It's got some logic, it's got some sense to it. So we can see we've got archers at the front, cavalry in the middle, and then shield and pike armed infantry at the back. That makes some kind of sense, and it has some tie-in with how forces were sometimes arranged in the period of, should we say, the Hundred Years' War or the Wars of the Roses. So we're looking at 14th and 15th century kind of technology level, and so comparing that to actual medieval battles, it makes some kind of sense. It also ties in with how, for example, Burgundian armies are represented in the 15th century, and they were supposedly emulating English armies by that point when they were fighting against the French and the Swiss and various other people. The basic idea being that you want your archers as far forward as possible so they can have the maximum range to put arrows onto the enemy army. And when it looks like it's closing to the two armies are coming together to hand-to-hand combat, the archers would usually fall back or form out of, sort of fall out sideways onto the flanks so they can still shoot into the opponents and allow the forces in the centre, the infantry or the cavalry, whichever it may be, to come forwards and engage the enemy. In this case, it makes a certain amount of sense because, of course, we later see that the archers are there, in fact, to shoot. They're pretty much the first actors, as was normal in the Wars of the Roses, for example. English army against English army, usually you'd have longbowmen at the front, and there would be a kind of archery duel at the beginning of the battle, so that's right. And the horsemen at the back, we know that they're going to be employed pretty much second straight after the archers. Well, we find out when we're watching the episode. And last acting are the infantry, so it makes sense that they are at the rear. The only thing I would say is, generally speaking, you wouldn't necessarily have all of your cavalry behind your archers. You might divide the cavalry, and this was often done in many battles. We know this was done at the Battle of Agincourt, for example. You would divide your cavalry into two forces and have them on the wings, because then they're protecting the flanks of your archers and your infantry, and they're more able to move forwards and backwards without getting in the way of the troops in front and behind. But there's different ways of doing things, and I'm sure that this was occasionally done. In actual fact, in terms of how this battle pans out, I think it would have made more sense to have the horsemen have the cavalry on the wings rather than having them behind the archers. However, I would say that perhaps it's to do with wanting to show the whole army in shot. And if you had the horsemen out on the wings, because it's a very, you can see the army goes from one side all the way around to the other, if you had the cavalry on the wings, then you wouldn't necessarily be able to see, as a viewer, that the cavalry was there at all. So we could say partly it makes logical sense, and partly it's probably cinematography trying to make the scene work visually and inform the viewer of the different elements of forces that are there and are going to take part in the battle. So it succeeded from that point of view. Now, I'm deliberately not going to talk about the whole scene with Ramsay and Rickon and Jon Snow and what happens to Rickon. That's not so that I'm not going to spoiler anyone out there, but just because I don't think it's really part of my review of the battle. It's actually to do with the story itself. So I'm going to skip over this part, and we're going to move to the next stage of the battle. And I would remind any viewers at this point, if you haven't seen this yet, probably stop watching now, okay? Should have done spoiler warning at the beginning, but as always with all of these, there's gonna be spoilers in this if you haven't seen this episode yet, okay? So I'm not gonna talk about this, I'm gonna move straight on to the actual fighting. Now I'm gonna talk a little bit about the makeup of Jon Snow's forces, that being a mixture of wildlings and various of the other families and cities that essentially given their fealty to him. And one of the recurring problems with Game of Thrones is, where are the fucking shields? Okay, so generally speaking, most of them aren't wearing heavy levels of armor. Most of the people in Game of Thrones in general, with a few exceptions like the Kingsguard and you know, people like the Mountain and such like, most of them aren't wearing heavy armor. Most of them were wearing what in a medieval context would be kind of medium lightish armor, okay? They might have a breastplate, they might have a helmet, although again, and in all of my videos I go on and on about this, where are the frickin' helmets? If you're only gonna wear one piece of armor, wear a helmet, okay? But let's leave that one aside for now. If you're wearing medium levels of armor, generally speaking, you're gonna want to use a shield. Why? Because in most medieval battles, what do the opponents often have? Bows or spears that will be shot or thrown at you. And quite simply, unless you've got head to foot plate harness, plate armor, then you need a shield to protect yourself from all of those missiles that are going to come your way. If we look at ancient world and medieval warfare, right the way through, they use shields. And the reason for that is because if you don't use shields, you get shot to pieces by a bunch of people with bows or crossbows, okay? When they start using shields less, it's because full plate armor has come in, and therefore that's already performing the job of the shield. You don't need a shield in addition to head to foot good quality plate armor. Or it's in the 16th century when firearms are starting to come in, and of course, you know, most shields aren't going to stop a musket bullet, or at least they might slow it down, but they won't necessarily stop it. And of course, there's artillery coming in as well in the 15th century. So once you've got artillery and handheld firearms coming in, shields become less useful. Having said that, ironically, shields actually saw a surge in popularity in the 16th century when armor started being abandoned because people realized that armor, for the most part, won't stop a cannon or a gunshot, and so they started removing armor and using lighter armor in many cases, not in all cases, and therefore shields came back in for some of those people. But anyway, I digress. Coming back to this, Why didn't Jon Snow just give his army shields? It's such an important thing. And in the past, we've seen many, many scenes in Game of Thrones where people have actually had shields and not used them. The shield's been hanging on the horse's saddle, or they have been holding a shield in the Tower of Joy fight, been holding the shield, and then mid-fight randomly just dropped the shield for no good reason. Shields are game changers, and not just in battles. In battles, shields are incredibly important because not only do they actively defend from someone who's trying to hit you, and sword and shield or spear and shield is a very, very powerful, very potent combination of weapons. It's better than dual wielding with two swords. Sword and shield is better. But not only in one-on-one situation, but in a multiple situation, if I'm with a bunch of buddies fighting together against some opponents, if we've all got shields, just we naturally have a shield wall. Whether we actually think form shield wall or not, we have all got shields in front of our force. That means we're protected from random missiles that we might not see coming our way. We're protected from random blows from someone over there who's hitting us while we're going to hit someone here and someone strikes over here. At least the shield is covering a line. So shields perform both active defense against a single opponent and a passive defense against an attack we didn't even see coming. So shields are good. Why doesn't Jon Snow's army have shields? Well, we could argue the wildlings just don't use shields. We do in fact see a few wildlings with shields later on. However, by and large, they don't use them. And we do see some of the forces under the Onion Knight actually do have shields. Some of them are carrying them, some of them aren't. By and large, they don't have shields. But this whole battle would have gone entirely differently if Jon Snow's army had actually had shields and used them. Okay, so my big criticism, and I'd like to see helmets as well, but my big criticism is they should have had shields. And if they don't have shields, they should have really long pole arms, like pikes, for example. Okay, and fundamentally, what they've done is they've gone to a gunfight with knives, okay? And they have not equipped themselves to fight a battle. Yes, we know that he was numerically inferior, and we know that he was thinking about tactics, but why the hell didn't he think, maybe we should use shields, or maybe we should use pikes, or maybe we should get some more archers? These three things, long pole weapons, pikes in other words, archers, and shields, if we look through the entirety of ancient world and medieval history, are game changers. Shield walls, whether we're talking about Viking era shield walls or Roman testudo, or if we're talking about massed archers, so if we look at English armies, Mongol armies, whatever, Turkish armies, or pike blocks, if we look at various Renaissance armies, or indeed Scottish chiltrons, Northern Welsh chiltron equivalents. These three things, long pole arms, shields, and archers, are really, really important. And Jon Snow's army doesn't really have any of those. It has some archers, but it doesn't have massed archers, it doesn't have shields, and it doesn't have long pole weapons. Jon Snow, you know nothing. Let's go on with the battle. And so the inevitable happens. Jon Snow is stranded out in the middle of the battlefield. The Bolton archers have started shooting a volley in his general direction, and so Jon's army says, "Charge!" And they all run, hell for leather. Now this is something that Hollywood, I'll say, but in this case not really Hollywood such so to speak, but TV and movies love. They absolutely love to have armies sprinting at each other. Historically, this doesn't seem to have happened very often. In skirmishes between small groups of troops, I'm absolutely certain that sometimes, you know, to take a position or reach a gate before it closed, this kind of stuff, if we read accounts from the Battle of Cressy campaign in 1346, for example, we do read accounts of men-at-arms and archers rushing to French defences to try and take them before the French defenders could man them properly and things like this. So I'm sure it did happen, but in set-piece battles like this, usually people don't run in a higgledy-piggledy fashion because it means that your line gets all disrupted, faster runners get there before slower runners, people with heavier equipment get there behind. People reach the line at all different rates, and you don't all meet the enemy at one time, which is a bad thing. Secondly, if you're using pole arms or shields, as you should be, then you're not gonna bring that to bear upon the enemy at the same time. A shield wall only works if you're all in a line, if you're all together and making a shield wall. lots of random shields arriving at different times doesn't make much difference. Pole arms equally, a pike block has to have a block. If you all arrive at different bits running with your pikes at different speeds, doesn't work. Cavalry is a little bit different. Cavalry can be allowed to hit, it's better if it hits as one, that's definitely the case, but if it does hit in a more of a higgledy-piggledy fashion, it's not so much of a problem. Infantry, more of a problem. So they start to run. Now, interestingly, although I've just therefore seemingly criticised this, I criticise that because it's so commonly used in movies and TV. Actually, in this case, it makes a large amount of tactical sense. Why? Well, firstly, the Bolton archers are just about to release a volley onto John's head. So presumably, his army wants to get level with him, partially to protect him. Also, they are angry. And so that is partly that is kind of the opposite of a retreat. They've kind of gone, ah, you bastards, and they've actually charged, okay? So partly it might not be controlled. But also, they're actually numerically inferior to their opponents. There's less of them, and they're worse armed, okay? So in an actual sense, if they stood there and waited for the enemy to come to them, they're just gonna get rolled up. They're gonna get wrapped up in a bag. The enemy who has more troops can form a longer line and can just envelope around them and they're dead. So in an actual fact, being numerically inferior, there being less of them, and the nature of the equipment that they've got, they don't have long pole weapons, they don't have many shields. You can see some shields around there, but not many. They've mostly got things like two-handed axes and swords and stuff like this. Actually not very good weapons by themselves. And so in actual fact, it does make a degree of sense for them to charge at this point. And of course, they've got 1-1. And 1-1 is, I mean, awesome. That's like having probably 100 extra men by himself. But he is obviously more effective as a weapon of aggression, a charging implement, like an elephant, for example, like Hannibal's elephants. That is more useful attacking than defending, generally speaking. Although, I do wonder, why didn't they build a really big shield for 1-1? Because I think if 1-1 had a really big shield, then he'd probably be pretty much impossible to defeat, except with a trebuchet. Anyway, let's move on with the battle. So there was a little detail there that I was actually quite impressed with. And I've done archery since I was a kid. I don't shoot very often anymore, unfortunately, because I don't have time. But when the archers started to shoot, John was essentially in range, yeah? So his brother had been shot. Sorry to spoiler anyone, but I did warn you, you shouldn't be watching if you haven't watched it already. But his brother was shot, so we know that he's in bowshot range. And he's got a choice, okay? His choice is to stand where he is, in which case he's gonna get a cloud of arrows on his head, or to run away, which has various problems because it could be discouraging to his army, or indeed it could be, and this is what I thought, this is the way I like to interpret it. Archer, if I'm an archer shooting at someone who's, say, 100 yards away, and I am ordered to shoot them, I will assume that they're going to run away. So probably what I'm going to do is I'm going to aim a little bit up, and I'm going to aim to put my arrow down probably 120 yards away, assuming that by the time my arrow gets there, he'll be running away. So the archers probably would assume that he was going to run away and therefore aim slightly further than where he was currently standing. And what he did actually was charge towards the enemy, which I actually thought was really clever. Now, I don't know if this was intentional or accidental, or if he's supposed to be charging because he's angry or some other reason. But I actually thought tactically it made a lot of sense. If you're standing there and there's a bunch of archers about to release a volley at you, probably, apart from having a shield, why doesn't he have a shield? Why doesn't he have a helmet? Anyway, apart from being armored or hiding under something or hiding behind something, if you've got to run in a certain direction, probably running towards the archers or sideways is the best thing you can do. If you run away, that means you're traveling in a straight line, okay? There's no lateral movement, it's easy to. You're running a straight line and they're gonna expect you to run further away. So I would say run towards them in a zigzag line. And HEMA connection here, this is actually similar. If you look at Girard Thibault's treatise, he shows a way of charging with a sword at someone who's got an arquebus aimed at you. And his advice, and any of you out there like me who play Mount and Blade, particularly Napoleonic Wars mod, will know this. If someone's got a musket aimed at you, you run in a zigzag line towards them. And you go, hit. And that seems to be more or less what Jon Snow's doing here. So I really, really like that. Let's move on with the battle. So this is an interesting point to stop it at. In actual fact, what do you do if all you've got is a long sword, not much armour, he's got a coat of plates but he doesn't even have a mail shirt underneath it, why? I don't know. He doesn't have a helmet, why? I don't know. Why doesn't he have a shield? Why doesn't he have a long pole weapon instead of just a sword? Sword's usually a backup weapon, he should have a spear or pole axe or something. Anyway, what do you do if you're just standing there in nothing but a coat of plates with a long sword and you have a line of cavalry charging towards you? I don't know. In short, there's no recommended advice of what to do if you're almost unarmored with only a longsword with a line of cavalry charging towards you. What I would say is I'm not that convinced that that his guard, which is something similar to in German it would be Vom Tag or Poste di Donna in Fiore or perhaps Guardia di Alta or something like that, but this kind of generic kind of ready to hit guard, I'm not sure that that's the best guard to really go into if you're expecting to be charged with cavalry. Probably something maybe with the point more in line or something to discourage the horses from coming straight at you. But if they're trained war horses, they'll probably just run straight over you anyway. So there we go. I don't think there's any best advice to John to do here. Let's carry on. Well, wasn't that lucky? So there we go, John didn't really have to do anything at that moment of impact. His cavalry, or at least the advance guard of his cavalry, got there in time to meet the opponent's cavalry. And I have to say, it was a bit dramatically done, but I actually thought it was really, really good, the way we saw the cavalry meet head on. And yeah, it looked realistic, it looked visceral, I liked it. Horses flying over, inevitably horses are going to get killed and fatally injured and badly injured in this kind of clash. We know that horses do run into each other, will run into each other, despite what anyone tells you who rides normal riding horses. Polo horses and jousting horses will indeed run into each other, and we know from accounts of warfare, even up until the 19th century, that horses will charge into each other, will smash into each other. And of course, two fast-moving, heavy horses, it's going to be messy. And of course, the people sitting on their backs as well, we've got lances and various types of hand weapons. The only thing I would say is on both sides, the cavalry looked very lightly equipped from my point of view. There should have been more helmets, more shields. Just more shields all the time, more shields. There's never enough shields in Game of Thrones for some reason. Historically speaking, if this was a recreation of, say, a 13th or 14th century battle, there would definitely, basically almost everyone who wasn't an archer, basically, would have a shield. Unless they had some really big two-handed weapon like a pike or a halberd or something. Okay, but I thought that was shown very well. Let's carry on. No.
Just come around, men. Stand down.
Yeah. Just a minor detail there, but I'm sure anybody who does archery will appreciate the fact that they use knock, draw, loose instead of aim and fire, because of course fire relates to matchlocks originally and using firearms. So great to see that they're actually using the proper terminology for bows. Okay, so I thought that was a pretty awesome sequence, really fun to watch. Not perfect, but what is, you know? I think that it was well choreographed, and I thought the way that the CGI cavalry coming in and passing, of course, the arrows, was done fantastically. It gave you a real sense of, well, probably actually, it doesn't, but it gives you a sanitized and slightly closer to a real sense of what a medieval battle must have actually horrifically been like. The thing that I was thinking the whole time when watching this, though, was, first of all, John was magically doing a lot of stuff. It was a bit Jedi-like. He kind of always seemed to know when something was coming in. It didn't look like he saw something and was like, holy crap, there's an attack coming in, defend, boom, riposte back, whatever. It seemed like he knew where each thing was coming in. And of course, that is an artifact of stage choreography. He did know where every attack was coming from. And so I think, although it was very, very good, it wasn't perfect. And it did look quite dance-like and not very scrappy, not as scrappy as I think they could have made it. And I have to say, I criticise the film Braveheart a lot, and it deserves being criticised a lot, but some of the fighting in Braveheart, for example, did look scrappy, it did look like real fights. And I think they got some of that here, but not all of it. I think they've gone for the gore and the brutality, but they've forgotten that a lot of the sense of chaos and everything being just terrifying comes from the acting. It doesn't come from the CGI and the blood and the gore and stuff like this. But nevertheless, I thought it was good. But the one thing that I was thinking all the way through watching this was like, John, you've got yourself into a fight where you've only got a longsword, okay? You're not wearing very much armor, you've only got a longsword. For fuck's sake, pick up some better equipment, okay? And yes, I know it's a Valyrian steel longsword and it can cut through White Walkers and blah, 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 but I don't care. The fact is, if he picked up a shield off the ground, he could still use his sword and he would be vastly better protected. Volleys of arrows keep falling down. Does he not think, I'm not really fond of these volleys of arrows that keep falling. And every time they come over, I crouch down and miraculously they don't hit me. That plot armor is really, really good. But what about some actual armor? What about a helmet? I accept in the middle of a fight, you don't have time to take a dead person's helmet off and put it on your head. But you do have time, absolutely, to either pick up a better weapon, like a spear or a halberd or something like this, or to pick up a shield. So, especially when there's like rain of arrows coming down on you every few seconds. So, I really, really wish that he'd picked up a shield and used it. We know from earlier episodes he knows what to do with a shield. So, there we go. Really annoying, yet again, that they didn't make more use of shields. Ironic, considering that later in this battle they make a lot of use of shields, but not on John's side. It seems that he needs to practice his shield lessons a little bit more and pass his shield exam. Okay, I think John got a little bit too fixated on stabbing someone who was already incapacitated on the ground there. That's one thing what I thought, yeah, they're trying to make it look as brutal as possible, but I'm just thinking, there's someone coming behind you. If you're in a battle where the opponents could come and try and take your head off from any direction, you don't stand there going, stab, 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 into someone who's essentially not a threat anymore. Okay, as soon as one threat's out, you're looking for the next threat. And that's why John, by rights, really should have got killed there, because he wasn't looking around. He needs to be looking around more. So it goes back to what I said before, that I didn't feel that he was, I felt like he knew where the threats were going to come from each time, and he wasn't actually physically looking for the threats as you actually would be in a real battle. Let's move on. So does it make sense for Ramsay Bolton to be shooting into his own men? Well, again, it's something that's become popular in modern TV and movies, and in fact I mentioned Braveheart, and it is shown in Braveheart as well. I'm not aware of any medieval general or medieval battle having used that, okay? But it works because it's Ramsay Bolton, it works, and it works within this context. He has more men, he can afford to expend those men. So I don't really have a problem with it, but I just want to point out, I'm not aware of it ever having been done historically. Okay, so one thing I think's good is that John's using his sword predominantly one-handed and actually using his left hand a lot to grab and grapple and this kind of stuff. That's good. I mean, I think he should have been using the sword a little bit more two-handed than perhaps he was showing this, but he does seem to prefer using his sword predominantly one-handed, and it's not a particularly long sword, but it's really good that he's making extensive use of that left hand to grab and grapple and stuff like this. This is good, this is historical, this is what was done with this type of weapon in the medieval period. So something that I think that isn't good is the fact that thrusting through armour abounds in this fight. Much like most of Game of Thrones, it seems that plot armour is far more effective than actual armor. And you know, we've seen, for example, the zombie mountain's breastplate pierced by a spiked cudgel. We've seen in the Tower of Joy fight, we've seen swords go through six layers of defense. So, you know, we've got gambeson, mail shirt, and coat of plate, front and then back as well. So it seems that they're promoting, and this annoys me slightly, they're promoting the idea, and this is very common in films and movies these days, they're promoting the idea that armour is just costume, that armour doesn't function as armour. And that's really annoying, because armour's awesome stuff. You know, swords get loads of glory, they get loads of attention, but really there are lots of other things in the world of medieval arms and armour that should get equal, if not more, attention. For example, other types of weapon. Pole weapons are really, in terms of battle, more important than swords are. In terms of armour, armour is incredibly important. It's a game changer. If you have a shield, if you have armour, it changes the nature of the fight totally. It changes so many things. It changes the balance of who's got the advantage. If one person has significantly better armor, or if one person has a shield and the other doesn't, it really changes the fight. And of course, in a battle, if you have an army that doesn't have shields or doesn't have armor, it completely changes the likely outcome of that battle. So it does annoy me, and I'm not genuinely annoyed. People always go, "Oh, Matt, don't get so worked up, it's only a show." I assure you, I'm not really annoyed. But, you know, I'm making a review for you to that has judgments in it. And one of my judgments is that armor should be starting to be represented in these types of modern TV and films as armor. It protects, it's really effective. And there are other places you can stab someone, like in their face or in their armpit. And this is what was done in armored fighting. So please stop showing swords that go straight through armor. And I know some of you will go, "Ah, but it's a magic Valyrian steel sword." Yes, that is true. Jon Snow has a magic sword. However, we can see many weapons going through armour, or apparently going through armour, in this battle and in fact in Game of Thrones as a whole. So there we go. Please start seeing armor, not just as like costume, as dress up. Okay, let's move on. Does anybody else hate that guy? Because I really, really do. I thought it was very interesting, by the way, that his sword was roughly modelled on a Highland claymore, because very clearly they're supposed to be like Highland Scots, aren't they? And I like that. So one thing I would say is what I'm going to do now is I'm going to fast forward a little bit of the battle, so I'm going to miss out a bit of a segment and we're going to move to the next, what I perceive to be the biggest, next important part of the battle. So I thought this was really good. They've got shields, yes, again, at last we've seen shields are a game changer. You'd think shields must have been around in their world for thousands of years, and yet, like, why do hardly any of these guys have shields, and yet all of these guys have gone, ah, we've got shields and pikes, and so therefore, you know, we've trumped you. Yeah, you know, Ramsay Bolton, I like the fact that they've shown tactics. He kettled them into an area. This is much like riot police tactics, incidentally. You kettle them into an area, boom, you lap them around. He's got superior numbers, several ranks deep, nicely represented. I really like the fact that they've got the wall of shields at the front, but they haven't just relied on a thin wall of shields as some movies have done in the past. But they've actually shown you have to have several ranks deep to give support to it and make it a strong shield wall. And then they've got pikes as well, which they can stab through. And I thought this was really, really well done. I have to say, the only thing I did think, in reality, if 1-1, who's standing there, was really that massive in real life, I think he could have just broken through a shield wall like that. I think he literally could have taken a run up and kicked. You know, like taking a goal in soccer. I think he literally could have kicked a gap straight through that shield wall. And, you know, these guys at this point kind of, I guess they feel a bit defeated and they don't know what to do. They haven't come up against this kind of opponent before. We can say all of those things, but really probably what they should have done, if you could coordinate them in any way, which I accept might be difficult because they've lost their command and control and their structure, is actually just all push in one direction. If this mass of men, look at the number of men here, if this mass of men pushed against that mass of men, they would break a hole in it. And having broken a hole in it here, they're now on the back of the shield wall and on the outside. And in fact, we see this with the cavalry later, that they form a wedge to break through it. So in actual fact, those men could have broken out of this, especially with the help of 1-1. But I do accept that they didn't have the command structure at this point to achieve that goal. Let's move on. So I would say it's a nice little detail that they've got people whose job in the front rank is just to hold the shields, or pavises as they were called, and then people behind with two-handed pikes. This actually makes the pikes vastly more effective than if you're trying to hold a shield with one hand and a pike with the other. So it makes the pike more unwieldy. That was done in the ancient world by Greek hoplites and such like. However, at this, they're more like Renaissance pikemen using them two-handed, and then you've just got shield bearers essentially in front to form a wall. I really like that. I thought that was a good idea, great idea. It's functionally, it works. It's got some relation perhaps to some of the things that Machiavelli talked about in his Art of War, but it makes sense and it looks plausible. I like the way it's executed. Now, the one thing I would say is about the wildlings. Now, I had to explain to myself when I'm rationalising this on viewing, I had to, in my brain, think, okay, well, they've never encountered these kind of tactics before, so they don't know what to do. I have to say, for my part, I have fought against spears. I use spears fairly regularly in sparring, but I have fought against spears myself many times, and I've done in reenactment as well. I've fought against bill blocks and stuff like this. And from my point of view, if you actually want to take out these people, if you want to fight against them as the wildlings, imagining you're a wildling now, all you actually have to do is grab the pike. And one of the disadvantages of pikes is they're very easy to grab hold of. And once you've grabbed hold of it, you've got as good a hold on it as the person on the other end has. You're both holding onto a stick, essentially. The pike is only dangerous when it's jabbing forwards and backwards. If they lift the point up, it becomes impotent completely. And so any one of these people, all they need to do is grab the shaft and basically keep a hold of it. And then once you're past the point, then really they can't, because they've got another line of shields behind them, they can't pull the pikes back far enough to get the point back online again. So in actual fact, I think in reality, it wouldn't be at all a problem. I don't think we would see a line of wildlings here and then a gap. I think what would actually happen is the pikes would pass between the people and these wildlings would be butted up against these shields. So in actual fact, the pikemen would be wanting to bring back their pikes so they could stab at this distance instead of stabbing out at this distance. So I think what the wildlings need to do is close in close against those shields. The shields themselves can't really hurt them. And so long as they're holding onto or staying aside of the pikes can't really hurt them either. And in actual fact, these guys, the front rank, with just shields, don't have weapons. So the wildlings can just grab hold of the shield and start stabbing over, as we see a few of them do. But they need to do it as a concerted effort. But they don't. Anyway, let's carry on watching. I thought it was an interesting scene when Jon Snow was crushed underneath the bodies and just being pinned down there. And I don't think it actually really added anything whatsoever to the battle scene as a scene. It just made it longer. I don't think it was particularly interesting. It doesn't seem to have been for any particular purpose. But nevertheless, I thought it was really interesting because it's not something that's been represented much on camera. And we know that historically this did happen. For example, at the Battle of Agincourt in 1415, it's very likely that the French army suffered, many of the men suffered this kind of fate of being essentially steamrolled by their own men as there was a kind of surge. And unfortunately, this does happen at modern sporting events occasionally, where crowds and indeed in riots and stuff. And it just shows you how, it reminds you, and it's humbling, of how impotent you could be. The most awesome swordsman, you could have the best armor, you could be the richest person around, but if a group of people basically steamroll you, there's nothing you can do. Okay, so I thought it was interesting and I liked it being in there, even though I didn't think it really added anything to the battle scene as a whole. I liked it because I thought it reminded you the fact that Jon Snow, he isn't this godlike, you know, resurrected, he's just a person who can be crushed to death by a bunch of people steamrolling, surging over him. Okay, right, let's carry on. So I'm just going to talk over this bit while it runs. I actually thought the interspersing this with the fight between Tormund and Lord Carstark was an interesting way of doing it, because I don't think either of those elements were particularly interesting by themselves, and I suspect that they were filmed as two separate scenes, and on editing they realised neither of those were particularly interesting, so they spliced them together, so they took up one amount of time between them. But I thought the fight between Tormund and Lord Carstark was not very interesting, but not bad. If it was an actual fight, Tormund uses something that's a bit like a long sax. And against someone using a long sword, you'd be at quite a disadvantage and you'd probably lose quite a lot of your fingers in a fight like that. But nevertheless, they were, as you see, tightly packed together and very compressed. And so it kind of worked. And funnily enough, in that situation, if you're squashed up against each other, then the sax, the shorter weapon, might have an advantage over the longer weapon because you can get more angles on it. But at this point, neither of them have got their weapons anymore, and Tormund wins it with the good old teeth, snaggle tooth. So there we go. And then, obviously, to wrap up, there's actually not a huge amount that I can say about this. A lot of us suspected this was coming. A lot of us realised that Sansa's letter was actually to Littlefinger, and of course Littlefinger commands this army effectively. So he's essentially the Lord of the Vale. And once this happened, we knew what was going to happen from that point onwards. We've got a shield wall that's facing inwards, and they're essentially not protected on the outside. Their pikes and their shields are pointing inwards, so therefore they're completely vulnerable to this cavalry force attacking them essentially in the rear, right up the butt, with a wedge formation nicely represented. I loved how they showed the cavalry. They were in some kind of formation. There we go, wedge formation. Breaks into the back of the shield wall. Anybody who's played the Total War series of games, particularly Rome Total War, this just looks exactly like that. And from my point of view, that's a good thing. That's what battles should look like on screen. So I thought this was really, really well done. So there we go. I'm going to leave you there with a bloodied and dirtied Jon Snow about to go and have a one-on-one encounter with Ramsay Bolton, and I might review that in a separate video, but for this is just the battle. I only want to talk about the battle here. So thank you for watching. I have been Matt Easton, and my channel Scholar Gladiatoria. Feel free to subscribe. I have other videos like this one. Have a look at my Tower of Joy video and my other Game of Thrones videos. And hopefully I've got other weapons and warfare related videos that you'll find interesting as well. Cheers, folks. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe, follow us on Facebook. You can buy t-shirts through Spreadshirt, support us on Patreon, or follow us on Pinterest. Thank you.